I wish I could wave a magic wand, and make everything all right, but it doesn't work that way. What really works is a contemplative society. When I am viewing the world as far as what's helpful and what's not helpful, it's only the only parameter I use is, does this help lead to a contemplative lifestyle, or does it mitigate against that? So that is my measuring stick for what is helpful and what is not helpful. And that's pretty much it, because a contemplative lifestyle has to be utilized in order to get through the brambles, the sticker bushes, of familiarity, of fear of lack of continuity, of all these half-truths that we've told ourselves. It just isn't a matter of waving a magic wand. It's really not. It seems like it should be, but these other factors interfere. So your success is really dependent on a sustained, intense, sustained, dedicated focus and effort, and it's not a matter of just getting a contact high somewhere. Although we'd want that to be the case, it'd be a lot quicker, wouldn't it? It hasn't happened. It doesn't happen. It doesn't work. So we have to do what actually works, and that is your ability and to focus in a contemplative way. And work with your own thoughts and your own awareness. You can listen to someone else, but you have to be able to examine your own thinking process and just look at it. Look at your own thinking process and the kind of excuses that you make, the kind of all of that, and try to get insight into what is really going on. Insight is beyond the intellect. The intellect is the booby prize. It's what cannot see. It's an attempt to see without seeing. It doesn't really, it cannot see itself, but you have a capacity within you to see the intellect. Something is beyond the intellect. And you can see the workings of the mind. There's something that is able to look and see the workings of the mind, and yet it itself is not entrapped or ensnared by those workings of the mind. It is some kind of very clear seeing that just says, "Now wait a minute, that's not right. Now wait a minute, that's just a trick. Now wait a minute, that it is there. You have that, and so you need to contemplate from that point of view, from that perspective." The intellect is trying to win battles, whereas the true reason is simply quietly looking and saying, "Okay, now this, that can't be true, right?" It points out the mistakes and just say, "Okay, this has to be, how is this going to be corrected? How will this be corrected?" You see the mistakes. And there are many, 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 many mistakes, all of them the same basic type, really. And that's what trips us up. We're constantly tripped up throughout our lives. Now, is a contemplative society in the works in the future? No, it's not. When I'm looking and observing this world from a quiet place of clarity, I just I'm looking to see where is the world going as far as, is it going toward contemplation or away from it? And it's going away from it. The more the intellect is worshipped and idolized, the worse it is for contemplation, because the intellect is what you do when you're not doing contemplation. That's the intellect. And we have a world culture now based on the foundation of the intellect. The intellect is the hero, because it seems to be sparing us the effort of contemplation. It's not sparing us the effort, it's just delaying the effort. And so it's not a good situation in this world at all. And just a few here and there getting free of delusion is no reason to really celebrate. There needs to be a culture where everybody is afforded an opportunity to work on contemplation. Much different society, much different civilization. Right now, again, we're worshiping the intellect and all that the intellect can seem to do for us, which is producing all this stuff, bureaucracies, materialism, and all the superficial lives that we live. The intellect is producing all of that, and we have all these universities, educational system, inventions and that we use. As we produced a world culture right now that's devoid of contemplation. In fact, it doesn't even recognize it. Again, so many times on the internet, I look at these major internet portals and they give you listings here. You can save your video, save this, do this, and all these different categories. And there's nothing to do with spirituality, religion, spirituality, contemplation as a subset of interest. It's not even an option. Not even an option. That shows you that this is guided by the intellect, because your higher reason, your true reason, would put that first. That'd be the first category. You know, the other stuff would be very minor compared to that. But it's the opposite. It's upside down. It's very indicative, extremely indicative. Do you think all these tech people get up in the morning and say, today I'm going to spend, you know, the entire day, maybe at least 4 or 5 hours in contemplation? No, they don't do that. The notion never crosses their minds. Today, they said, today I'm going to see what I can get out of the intellect. I know there's more. I'm going to mine the intellect and see what the intellect can accomplish. Whereas contemplation knows the intellect cannot accomplish anything. Nothing of meaning. Nothing of consequence. Yeah. It's a waste of time. It's a delaying tactic. That's all that it is. So I tend not to get into intellectual discussions at all, or back and forth at all. It's a complete waste of time. Because the intellect cannot know. It doesn't know. It cannot arrive at any conclusion. Nothing meaningful. It's just like a slave to this belief system we have. So my forecast of the future is not a good one at all here. There are isolated pockets maybe of contemplation here and there. But the overwhelming trend, you know, 99.9999% is going in the wrong direction, wrong emphasis, and that ends up producing consequences that we don't like. How different it would be if the emphasis on education was on contemplation rather than the intellect. How different it would be. I went through the school system, never one time ever did I have anyone ever mention contemplation. Never. How can that be? Is that an education or a miseducation? Is it an education or an indoctrination? Is it an indoctrination? You're being indoctrinated into the goals and agenda of the intellect, and being told that the intellect is somehow supreme, that is like your God. And I said, no, that's crazy. You got it all wrong. And eventually just lost all interest. This is a complete waste of time. You'll find that those who don't even have any schooling are more intelligent than those who do. Because they don't trust the intellect as the end all and be all. And they're much more observant. People who cannot read or write or illiterate people are actually wiser and smarter than people who've gone through got a PhD, because they simply they're observant. That they'll observe very, very acutely, observe and say, they can see, what's going on around them. Whereas a PhD is only seeing what the intellect tells them they're supposed to see. Not to say that the illiterate people are enlightened, they're not. But they're also not as severely indoctrinated. The intellect doesn't know, it doesn't know, it doesn't have a clue. Doesn't even have a clue as to what is what. It's just self-reference. It references itself. And you end up wandering in mazes. It's truly amazing. Intellect is amazing. Mass of mazes. So here we are, setting that to the side, not condemning it or beating it up or anything, just to say, hey, intellect is not it. It's not it. If you use it like a tool, fine, but realize it's just a kind of a worthless tool. Maybe it's a tool you can use to earn a living, that kind of thing. But as far as the importance in your destiny, importance for your sanity, importance for your happiness, it's useless in that way. And today I was looking at the big picture. Always look at the big picture. There's all sorts of events taking place each day. Some of them seem to be, very important. But the big picture remains the same. The actual situation of existence. Excuse me. Actual situation of existence remains the same. Doesn't change. Insanity. We're in the grip of insanity. It's the opposite of sanity. We're in the grip of insanity. And we have to get free of that grip somehow. And the intellect doesn't know how to get free of it. Cannot get you free of it. It simply avoids that. It might try, etc., but it doesn't have the escape velocity that's necessary. Truth is not complex. Reality is not complex. There's no complexity to it whatsoever. Zero. Everything is exactly the way that it is. It's not like you're looking for something else. It's not like you see something and say, okay, but that's only part of it. Well, where's the rest of it? And it's not like you see something and say, what's this going to become? Okay, I see this, it's a little seed, but what's it going to become? It's not like that at all. Unconditional love is not complicated. It doesn't need any time to mature. Okay? It's not engaged in some process. And yet we view reality through the lens of insanity, of our dream that we have conjured up out of nothing. And we think that reality must be this way, the way that this existence, this world is. We take this world as a foundation, a template, and then try to view reality through that template, and that causes the problems. And we use our intellect and say, okay, we'll take this as what is real, and then we'll extrapolate from this how reality must be. And we think, okay, we're doing a great, smart, intelligent thing. We're not. We're doing a crazy thing. Because this world is not a template of reality at all. It's the opposite, almost. Just completely has nothing to do with reality. So we can't use this world, nature, as a template for reality whatsoever. It has nothing to do, zero. You can never understand what reality is by looking at nature and existence. This world, the universe, has no similarities. It is just completely bizarrely, alienly different. Different to unimaginable extent. And yet the intellect, again, is thinking, okay, we have some foundation here, which is the world. Let's build upon that foundation and let's see where we can go. That is the wrong approach entirely. What reason will say is this world has nothing to do with reality. Okay, so how do we remember reality? Not by building on the foundation of this world of nature, not at all. So therein lies the problem. There's this gigantic problem. We have a world which is worshiping itself, which is saying this world must be the work of a great creator. And it is, because spirit is a great creator. It's the work of spirit. However, it's not the work of the prime creator. Okay, and it's the prime creator that creates reality. It's not spirit that created reality. Spirit did not create reality. So this world is the work of a great creator, which is spirit, but it's a imaginary hypothetical scenario, okay? It's not real. It doesn't tell us anything about reality. So we have to take it that further step. And that's where we, you know, get tripped up. Those who are worshiping the creator of this world are just worshiping themselves. Spirit worshiping spirit. And spirit saying that spirit is God, is the prime creator. It's not true. This is a great, existence is a great outpouring of creativity. Actually, it's imagination, an outpouring of imagination. It is a great testimony to the creativity of spirit. But it's not a great testimony directly to the great creativity of the prime creator. Indirectly, you can say it is. But it's not something that the prime creator created. So we have this mix-up. We have this mix-up between this distinction. We don't make this distinction. The world comes up short. The intellect comes up short. We've been coming up short. And we just have to get over this slight difficulty. And it's so difficult to do. So few do it. Okay, just one second here. Be right back. Okay. There is this just seemingly insurmountable, almost, difficulty we have in this world, because we simply go around in circles, never able to quite pull free of the gravity or the gravitas of our own self-worship and what the intellect seems to do, and we just remain enthralled here. It's really enthralldom, and there's no magical, there isn't any magic that'll take care of it. We keep on trusting in magic. We keep on believing there's some magic, because, of course, the purpose of existence is to give us the magical power over the prime creator, over reality itself. And the very fact that we chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, that's choosing magic. That's a belief in magic, and we believe it's possible. Not only possible, it's a certainty. Otherwise, we would drop the idea, because it's only suffering. So we believe it's a certainty we will succeed in developing a power that's over reality, that can destroy reality, and then use that as a threat to the prime creator to change reality for us. and we have to believe this will succeed. We have to. So we have this magic belief that this must succeed magically, somehow, through some magic, through transmutation, some transformation, somehow what can never be will somehow become, you know. And so we're just waiting for magic. We believe in magic so much, we even think our enlightenment, our freedom from magic, is based on magic. And we're waiting for that to happen. And it never happens. There is no magic. There's nothing in existence that can free us from existence. Only by choosing a different idea do we get freed from existence, freed from the effects of existence. But instead, we just wait for magic. We're so used to believing in magic. So used to it, it just trips us up. So no one should hate themselves or be upset at themselves for this, because that doesn't lead anywhere. One has to, again, contemplate. Contemplation is an unemotional type of situation. Your reactions are not amplified or pursued. You just see it as it is and just say, okay, that's what that is, okay? And you just continually see instead of react. And when reactions happen, you don't do anything about them. You just bring your attention back to more seeing. It's like that. Of course, there's going to be some upsets and shocks and oh, well, and just let that all just happen, and you just remain like you're driving on a freeway, and pew, all these cars are going past you, and billboards and off ramps and all this stuff, and you just keep driving. You see all the stuff flowing past you, and all the traffic around you, and cars cutting in front of you, you know, and there's just someone slow, and you got to go around. You just keep driving. You keep driving. That's what contemplation is. It's like driving. You're not honking your horn, you know, somebody driving poorly, you don't scream and yell and honk your horn. You just say, okay, here's a problem, I need to drive around this, okay, and you just drive like that. Driving is actually one of the better disciplines, especially in areas with a lot of traffic, a lot of stuff going on, because it teaches you how to stay in the moment. It's very close to contemplation. It teaches you not to react, no road rage going on, okay? You just say, I need to get to where I'm going because it's very, very important I get there. Let's say you're going to your wedding or something, or you know, think of this, some very important destination, you have to get there. You're very kind, you're very loving on the road, you're peaceful, someone wants to get in, okay. All these people driving weird, that's fine, not a problem. I'm not gonna let it bother me, I need to get to that wedding. It's like that. Contemplation is very much like that. That's not to say that if you just drive all the time, you're going to see through delusion and choose a new idea, no. It's just that discipline can be brought into contemplation. And you can say, oh, this is not so strange. I just need to keep on moving towards choosing a new idea. And whatever is getting in my way, here's a traffic jam, okay? Let's not lose our cool. So slow down. Is there a way to get around it? Maybe I need to take surface streets around this. There's construction going on the freeway. You know, all this stuff is going to happen. All these difficulties and troubles, irritations will arise. Just like doing some, you know, really terrible commute with all sorts of stuff going on, you know, CHP has pulled people over, the construction, traffic jams, accidents, speeders, guys, people going too slow, motorcycles cutting around, everything, the whole bad weather, you name it. And you just stay. You're in control, you're driving, and you got your foot on the gas, and you can put on the brake, and you're just making your way steadily. You just make your way steadily towards your goal. That's what you have to do. That's what everybody has to do. And eventually you can get a perspective and leverage on the entire belief system, and you can trace it back, and you can see
why it is so difficult to get free of it. Don't be afraid. That's the most important thing to see, is why is it so difficult? Why are we so trapped? You would think that, you think, oh, that's the one thing I don't want to look at. It'll frighten me. It'll ruin my motivation. No, it's the opposite. When you see how it is that we're so trapped, and you say, aha, oh, now I see. Oh, okay, that's what's been delaying me for so long. How silly, how foolish. You know, that's ridiculous. It was just uncalled for, unfounded. You see that and you say, oh, okay, now I'm not nearly as trapped anymore. So it's not a frightening thing to look at why is it so difficult? Why are we so trapped here? It's the most important thing to do. So don't be scared about that. That's what contemplation is. What are the obstacles? What is stopping me from doing what I know would bring me happiness? Would free me from death and misery and suffering and fear and confusion and doubts and frustrations and everything, and bring me, you know, delight. What is it that's preventing that from happening? And again, you don't have to go anywhere or do anything, because what's preventing it from happening is the refusal to choose a new idea. The only way to get free of the effects of one idea is to choose another idea, and then you'll have the effects of that idea. What doesn't work is keeping the same idea and trying to change the effects of that idea. That doesn't work. That's what doesn't work. And that's what the intellect is engaged in. It's trying to change the effects of an idea. And what reason is engaged in is telling you to choose a new idea. That's all. It's very simple. And you just contemplate on that. Just look at it and say, okay. Very simple. Intellect is trying to change the effects of an idea. Reason is telling me to choose a different idea. Change the idea. Don't work on trying to change the effects. Very much black and white. Very clear-cut difference there between the intellect and reason, right? One works, the other won't. Won't work. And yet the one that doesn't work is saying, well, it's just never worked yet, but magically it will work at some point. That's what it always says. It always appeals to magic and says, we ask of it, if it's never worked and I don't see any way that ever will work, how can you keep justifying? And intellect will say, magic, it'll happen magically. You just hang in there. It's somehow correlated with our willingness to delay and to hang in there and be loyal. Somehow that's supposed to give rise to catalyze the magic. So we blame ourselves for the lack of magic. And this self-hatred builds and builds and builds and builds in the world. The more the intellect is pursued, the more self-hatred there is. Because we think that our lack of success is based on our lack of loyalty, our lack of commitment. That if we just committed more and were more loyal, that would catalyze the magic. That is what we believe. And this is a lie. This is not true. There's no such thing as any magic that can change the effects of an idea. There's no such thing as any magic that can produce a power over reality. No, will never happen. And the intellect blames us, you know, says somehow we're doing something that isn't right, which is why magic has not arrived, has not catalyzed it yet. So you get a lot of this self-loathing, self-blame, and desire to punish oneself. And this builds up, a complex builds up, and that's what actually wars and all violence and terrible situations in the world feed off of that. They come from it. They come from this syndrome of self-hatred, which is fueled by the intellect, which is fueled by the belief in magic. And it erupts, you know, and wants to get rid of this feeling, and projects and says, the reason why I hate myself is because someone else out there is causing me to hate myself. They're undermining my efforts or something, because it's projected, and then the projection is attacked in the attempt to get rid of this feeling of self-loathing is very strong. When you contemplate, you don't have this self-loathing. You don't have this guilt. You don't have this self-hatred. You still, the irritations of the world are still there, and disappointments, you know, because the world won't pay any attention to contemplation as a disappointment. But as far as projecting and saying, you know, these people out here are the cause of my suffering and misery and hate, self-hatred, etc. And if they were gone, I would be happy. That doesn't happen, because we see that that's a delusion. That comes from following a false premise, a false idea, false belief system, a mistaken belief system, a delusion. The belief in magic is a delusion. The belief that there's some way that magic can change the effects of an idea is a mistaken belief. And mistakes only call for correction within us, not in someone out there, within us. We correct it at its root. We're the ones who are choosing the idea of trying to be prime creator. Each aspect of spirit is choosing that idea. All that are experiencing existence decided to choose that idea. And the suffering and all this delusion is inevitable to any aspect of spirit that chooses that idea. They will fall into this trap of trying to change effects instead of choosing a new idea. And the only remedy there is to choose a new idea, not to try to change effects. So external change is not the answer. And therefore war is not the answer, is it? If we want peace on this planet, as you hear all the pop icons saying, you have to have a culture of contemplation. There's no other way. There is no other way. The way that peace is being pursued right now is only going to make matters worse in this world, which is top-down bureaucracy, draconian laws, trying to intimidate everybody into some sort of compliant pattern of doing what the bureaucrats want them to do, and the bureaucrats saying that that'll make them happy, and when they're happy, you'll be happy. It's kind of a vicious circle of insanity there that takes place. And then, of course, the bureaucrats will say, well, the reason why we're unhappy is over there, some other country, some other people. You know, it's just constantly pushing everything outside, outside, outside. It's over there. It's over there. Instead of it's in here, it has to do with our choice, our refusal to choose a new idea, our insistence on magic. And again, the only way we could choose the idea of trying to be prime creator is a belief in magic. We decided to believe in magic. And the belief in magic gives rise to time and space. It's saying it takes time to generate this magic. What else can it say? What else can it do? Because there's no magic in the moment. There's no magic now. So it has to say it's in the future. Future means time. Right? As soon as there was, we believed in magic, we believed in a future. And we believed in space. Because there's no magic right here either. So if it's not here, it must be out there somewhere. So it's out, we believe it's out there in time and space. And it's not. There is no magic. So our whole search in time and space is just an aimless wandering around that turns up nothing. There's no magic here. There's no magic now. We choose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. It means change reality. There is no change of reality here. There's no change of reality now. The famous saying in the 60s was, be here now. That was the mantra of the 60s, be here now. And yet the intellect, you know, just has continued on more than ever. More than ever. new champions arise. People do get disillusioned with the intellect, but as soon as that happens, new champions of the intellect arise. And it just continues on and on and on. So disaffection does happen. But the intellect always has a new group that is willing to grab the baton and keep it going. Let's change effects. Let's keep believing in magic. Yes, we can. We can do it. And no, we can't. The mind should be here now, and anything else is nowhere. It's nowhere. But even being here now is not enough. That's a nice slogan, very catchy. But we have to choose a new idea. The power of now should be the power of choice. We have to choose a new idea. We be here now, we can realize, wait a minute, there is no magic here now. But still, what do we do with existence? Well, we have to choose a different idea and overlay it, an overlay of existence. Unconditional love. We have to still make that choice. And that's where we've come up short. The 60s was a time of heightened awareness and options. It was a time when people were assessing their options, realizing that there were two roads now to go on. Suddenly we became clear, well, wait a minute, you know, if we go down this road of the intellect, this is where we're going to go. And if we go down this road, this is much more promising. There was that realization. But those who have gone down the road of the intellect, of course, they seem to be in control of the planet and are all powerful and all that, which is a mirage, because they're heading pell-mell into their own, you know, into destructivity. Those who have gone down the road of be here now, they haven't yet gotten to the place of choosing a new idea yet. They've kind of set up dharmasalas along the way. They've kind of set up ashrams along the way, rest stops along the way, and set up shop, you know, along the way, as it were, and haven't finished the job. Because on that path, the journey is not the goal. The destination is the goal. The journey is a difficult one. So the journey, the whole idea of contemplation is to finish as fast as possible. It's not an end in itself at all. Whereas the road of the intellect and trying to change effects and belief in magic, they always say, oh, the journey is what it's all about. It's the journey that's important, not the goal. You hear that mantra all the time. Of course they have to say that, because there is no goal. You can never reach the goal. So of course they have to say, enjoy the journey. It doesn't have anything else. If you don't enjoy the journey, there's nothing else at all to it. And the journey is not enjoyable at all. We can, you know, dress it up and ornament it and stuff, but it's not enjoyable. So in contemplation, again, finishing as fast as possible. It's not an end in itself at all, nor is it trying to be. It's trying to drop it. It says, finish up and drop this. Okay, be done with it. Be done with it as quickly as possible. And yet we haven't done that. We haven't done it. We're still waiting. The world is still waiting for those to finish, waiting for those who have taken this path to finish it. We're still waiting for that. Why don't we wait? Why don't we finish? Because we're still hanging around to think, well, I wonder what kind of magic's going to happen in the world. There isn't going to be any magic. Technology was tripped a lot of us up because we thought, well, you know, what is this? There may be some kind of magic here. And now we realize, no. You know, wow. It's Pandora's box. And each group that is supposedly going to produce the magic, who has the baton, they keep demanding, you know, hey everybody, it's our time on stage, pay attention to us, we're going to bring the magic. It's our day in the sun, and you'll be shortchanging us if you don't pay attention to us. And by your paying attention to us, that is going to give rise to the magic. That is delusion. It gives rise to demagoguery. It gives rise to so many ills in the world. that supposedly if we just give attention to those who are on stage, that that'll generate some kind of magic, which will then transmute the hypothetical into a real. It will never happen. It's a waste of time. So we haven't yet had those finishers in the world. I can just tell you that. That is true. We had some fake finishers. Those who told us that they had finished. Because we wanted so desperately to believe. We wanted so desperately to believe that, you know, someone's going to finish. We can finish it. We can do it. That it gave ripe to a spiritual demagogues who claimed that they had finished, and then we wanted to believe that. We wanted to believe it. But alas, it wasn't to be so. Most people who are on the spiritual path, almost everyone knows very well what I'm referring to in general, in that there are those who claim that they have finished and they haven't really finished. They set up a Dharma Sala somewhere and expect you to come in and worship them to produce the magic that they think they need to finish. They're still caught up in the belief in magic, except they're hiding it by, you know, putting on the trappings of a guru, one who has finished, a finisher, and then setting up shop and saying, come here and then worship me and submit and all this kind of stuff. And they're supposedly giving you the energy. Really, they're taking your energy, your adulation. They're spiritual demagogues. And then they believe that's going to produce the magic. And we as spiritual aspirants have fallen into this trap. Some more severely than others, depending on the belief and how severe the belief in magic is. That's how vulnerable you are. I think almost everyone has fallen into that trap. It's almost inevitable, because your belief in magic will pull you there. And one way or another, by hook or crook, some type of Dharma Sala is going to attract you along the way. Some billboard, you know, is going to have you put on the brakes and say, wow, maybe there's real magic here, you know. For sure. And so the thing to do is just get back in your car and keep driving again. Just take it as a lesson learned, you know, a teaching moment, so to speak. You're going to get scammed by this. It's your own attraction to magic that causes it. It's your own belief in magic that is the cornerstone of this entire experiencing or lack of experiencing you've had in existence. The belief in magic is the cornerstone to it. It all rests upon that belief in transmutation, transformation. There's something that can turn a hypothetical into reality. That's a belief in magic, and there's no such capability, ever. And yet, we have to believe that just to entertain this idea in the first place. So we are severely addicted to this belief, and it leads us astray. It does. So one way or another, we will find ourselves, you know, tripped up and led astray, and we'll stop somewhere and we'll get involved in something, and it'll waste our time and it'll be a regretful experience, and we'll be shaking our head and say, okay, we just got deluded into trying to make the magic work one last time. Trying one more time, maybe this will finally get the magic to work, because we're a little afraid of finishing. Okay, so before you finish, you will see these, as you come up to try and finish, you will see all these ashrams around the finish line, and they'll say, hey, you know, come on in. And you'll kind of be afraid to finish. You say, okay, let me check this out. And you check out, and before you know it, check this out, and you're all caught up in all this magic, and you don't finish. That's exactly what takes place here. I certainly have been tripped up that way, scammed in various ways, severely, because this magic will appeal to you in whatever form you're vulnerable to. That is the truth. And we all have vulnerabilities, all of us. We all have a way that magic can approach us so that we'll believe in it. Every one of us does. So don't, you know, hate yourself or get angry about that. It's exactly what happens. It just means that you're trying to finish. Okay, that's what it means. And it means you're you're afraid of finishing for some reason. You need to then contemplate, why are you afraid of finishing? Because there is no reason to be afraid of finishing. Whatever fear there is of finishing is unfounded. It has no real basis. It itself is a deception. That fear is a deception. We fear the lack of the familiar, but by choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator, there's a continuity. Unconditional love, there's an overlay of everything. So everything remains. The dream remains, but it's overlaid. Okay. Let's say in wintertime you live somewhere and you look out and you see all the homes and streets or the fields and you see the whole landscape, okay? And then a soft, gentle snow comes and it just barely, you know, dusts everything with this beautiful, you know, gentle white carpet, you know. You're not freaking out because you're still seeing the familiar landscape. It's just been transformed by the snow a little bit. Perceptually, maybe quite a bit, and yet you're not panicking. You're not seeing a loss of continuity, loss of the familiar. The basic time, space, orientation, everything is still basically there, and yet you're seeing it perceptually, you're seeing something different. It's exactly very similar to that. Unconditional love, it's as if there's this soft blanket of snow over the entire universe. Everything is still and quiet and peaceful and beautiful. And yet the whole universe is still there. It's being overlaid. So there's no reason to be afraid whatsoever. And there's no intensity to it. It doesn't build and build and build. It's not like eating a ghost pepper, which I did on Labor Day. And, you know, first you think, oh, it's no big deal. This is great. And then suddenly it starts building and building and building and just keeps building and building. And then you start freaking out because you don't know where the ceiling is, right? You don't know how far is this going to go? It's just getting hotter and hotter and hotter. And you start thinking it might just keep doing this forever, you know, and your mind starts panicking. Eventually the ceiling was reached and then you realize, I reached the ceiling, and then the mind stops panicking. And you think, I'm gonna make it through. But unconditional love isn't like that. It's a soft overlay, and it doesn't get any more intense. It doesn't get any more intense. It's not a buildup of intensity. There's no process involved. What may happen is that our awareness, our acceptance of it, we get more familiar with it, and we seem to delight in it more and more. But that's something that's under our control. It's not that there's some greater intensity. It's because it's an unchanging effect. It's an effect that's not changing. It overlays everything simultaneously. It's not changing. So there are these fears that we have about finishing. That leads us to getting hooked up with these fake finishers who haven't finished but are having their ashrams near the finish line as if to say they have finished. And we get entangled with that. And what we have to do is we have to get disentangled, and we have to go back to contemplation, and we have to see, why are we so afraid of finishing, and see through those fears. They are resolvable. They're based on a misunderstanding of what's going on. It's just there's a lack of emphasis on finishing in this world. A tremendous lack of emphasis. How can those who have not finished emphasize finishing? It's pretty difficult unless they're very, very honest. And see, I have not finished, but I'm saying I haven't finished. 100%. I'm not setting up some big ashram saying I've finished. That's crazy. Because that just, I mean, I want to finish. That's why I'm not doing that. If you set up yourself as having finished and you haven't, you're just delaying your own finishing severely, severely. Because you get all these people telling you finished, and you think your finishing then is dependent on duping all these people continuously. And you can't go into contemplation, really, because people say, what are you doing? You've already finished. Why are you contemplating? You know, it's a terrible situation. So really the best thing you can do to set those free, those who have said they finished, they haven't, set them free, because they can't finish as long as you keep going to them. Go back to your contemplation. Ask yourself, why am I afraid of finishing? Because those who have not finished cannot take your hand and help you across the finish line. They cannot, because they're terrified of finishing. Otherwise, they would have. Otherwise, they would have finished. Okay? And so they will simply convey their fears of finishing to you, but in a way that is not helpful. We need to contemplate on the fears we have, to look at them and carefully analyze them, carefully look at them, and diffuse the fear within them and realize, ah, that's stupid. That's really stupid, you know. That's no reason not to finish. That's no reason not to choose a new idea. That is what we literally have to do, and by doing that, we then are able to finish. At some point, we're able to finish, and finishing means choose a new idea. There is no other finish at all. There is no other finish. If you haven't chosen a new idea, you haven't finished, period. And there have been those that have finished. They're examples in history. And they tell us that you definitely can do it. That's what they say. In fact, you have to do it. You will do it. Only the time you take, the amount of delay is up to you. But as far as finishing, you have to, because there is no magic to change a hypothetical, to transmute a hypothetical into the real. There isn't. So you'll just continue to wander around aimlessly like an ant in search of some kind of food that you can never find. Or like that. You see ants looking for food, just kind of zigzagging, wandering aimlessly in circles everywhere. We're like that. We're really like that. All the while telling ourselves, there's some food, and we know there's some food. We got to find it. We know it must be there. It has to be there. There isn't any. There isn't any magic to be found. None. There's only stuff that we keep investing our faith and hope and belief in, that it can do, can have a transmuting magical effect, but it never can. So that's why we keep following these leaders, these demagogues, these belief systems, these gurus, you name it, political, spiritual, social, all these various levels. So we keep following them, investing our hope, faith, and belief in them, believing that they can generate the magic together. We are magic, you know, that kind of thing. And it never happens, and therefore we get severely disappointed in them, severely disappointed in these leaders and gurus, etc., that they themselves haven't finished. They're holding up this magical belief saying, together, we can do it. And you think, wow, this is what I've been waiting for my whole life. Finally, there's this leader that says, yeah, together, we can do it. And you get tied up in that and you waste your time. And you get upset at others saying, you know, how come you aren't participating too, because it takes all of us. You know, if we all just get in on this. And that's another way of delaying, is thinking, well, it hasn't worked because there's not enough of us who are doing it. But if we all pull in the same direction, pull on that rope, magic rope, you know, we're all, then it will succeed. And so what those people do is they keep trying to recruit, thinking that, you know, if we just get enough, the magic will happen. Like, that never happens, never happens, never will happen. So that's all a waste of time. Just to disengage from that, give yourself a pat on the back, realize this is absolutely what happens. Because you want to be free, you went towards freedom and you got a little bit frightened, you were a little bit unsure, you didn't have a strong enough foundation in contemplation, and so that belief in magic, you know, sidelined you for a while. So just get back on the path. Start contemplating. Again, it's like driving. Don't let anything sidetrack you. Ask, why am I afraid to choose a new idea? That's inquiry. Why is there this fear to choose a new idea? What's the basis? Take it as a premise that there is nothing, no trauma involved at all. Okay, take that as your premise. You can put your faith and belief in that. There is no trauma whatsoever in choosing a new idea and experiencing the effects of that new idea, the overlay of unconditional love. There's no trauma at all. Take that as a given, and then ask yourself, okay, if that is a given, then why am I afraid? See, where's the fear coming from? And we've, you know, these videos, discuss this. It's just a discussion. These videos are really a discussion, a contemplation, examination of our fear. Why are we afraid to finish, to choose a new idea? Why? Because it's only fear that's holding us back. It's only fear. Our own fears are holding us back. So as I close in on finishing, I've been experiencing these fears. I'm looking at them for a long time, and I'm just sharing this because why not? You know, it is important to share with others the path so they see, okay, there is a path. There is a way to contemplate. There is a way to get closer. There is a way to diminish the fear. And it's helpful to share this, I believe. That you're not alone, the difficulty, you're not alone. You're not stupid if you got scammed or tripped up. Because I definitely got tripped up and I'm not stupid. Okay? It's that absolutely happens to almost everyone. Almost, maybe multiple times. And maybe very severely. My situation was very severe. It was so elaborate. It just caused, you know, absolute disaster in my life. Because the presentation was just simply, you know, done so artfully that there's almost no way to see through it, except, you know, if you just say, wait a minute, if you know the truth, you just say, wait a minute, you know, it's very difficult. You just have to get back on track and finish. And see, is this finishing? Don't think that you have to save the world or change the world at all. You're going to get fooled. That is just almost assume that's going to happen at some point. You know, I wish I could tell you how not to get fooled. I don't think it's possible. Because the approach will be so clever. So clever. You know, whatever approach works will be worked on. Your own imagination will conjure up whatever it takes to fool you, because that's what you're asking. You're afraid to finish, a little bit afraid, and so you will conjure up some great excuse not to finish, some great excuse, irresistible excuse, something that seems flawless. You know, oh, this is I'm going to help save the world because I'm going to do this, and you know. What you have to do is you have to pick yourself up and say, okay, I still had too much fear of finishing, which is why I got tricked. I tricked myself. I conjured up some, you know, irresistible scheme that I thought was going to help everybody else finish, right? And now that was just a way of delaying myself. Pick yourself up from that. Remember, we're all complete geniuses. We were using our imagination. Our creativity has been turned toward imagination and plausibility, and so we use all this plausibility to trick ourselves. We're geniuses at tricking ourselves. So certainly, if we're still afraid to finish, we will trick ourselves, guaranteed. How else can we delay other than by tricking ourselves? That's how we delay. So that's what we do, and. The thing is, we will. This trickery is ruthless. You know, it has no conscience, because we're asking to be tricked. We're afraid. We think, "Wow, I don't want to finish. It's too frightening." So, how can I make it seem like I'm finishing, except I'm not? You know, and then we will conjure up some very clever tricks, so we think that we're finishing and we're not. We think that we think we're engaged in finishing, and we're actually simply delaying. But we won't realize it, maybe for quite some time. You know, I got led down the primrose path. And it's amazing how you can lead yourself down that path of delay. Amazing. Incredible, really, incredible. Because you're using your own creativity to do it. And that, it lingers, because again, the fear of finishing automatically has has you appeal to magic. It's like, help me, magic, help me, magic. I'm afraid, I'm scared, I'm scared. Then your imagination will find some way to enmesh you into magic, into thinking that someone else, something else, can finish for you, or you don't really have to finish. You don't have to choose a new idea. That there's some other way. There's some other way. And that you don't have to do it right now. You know, there's some time and space thing. It's just amazing how you can. So this is what needs to be looked at, because people, what I've seen in this world is everybody getting tripped up. Everybody getting tripped up and coming up short. So that has to be addressed. It has to be addressed. And you don't even have to get tripped up by some fake guru. I got tripped up through inner awareness. You know, and it wasn't some guru out there. It was something that was a process of guidance from within that I got tripped up on. And you, it's amazing, because you think, well, you're getting guidance, which I was, but it wasn't the right guidance. You can get guidance, but guidance that is leading you astray. Absolutely, you can get that. And the guidance will seem to be divinely inspired too. And the guidance will use whatever props it needs to make you believe you're getting divine guidance, when in fact you're not. But in fact, you are being led astray into magic, the belief in magic, which is the belief that you can change the effects of an idea. That's delay. Belief. And so it's not just the fake finishers out there. You can generate an entire scenario of delay internally, from within, that seems like it's coming inspired, divinely inspired. You absolutely can do that. That's what I did. I was able to do that and just generate all this delay and enmeshment, and truly astonishing. And yet it's a very important to point this out. It's not only the fake gurus out there, and there are many. If they don't trip you up, you will generate one from within, from your own imagination will generate, and you will feel that this fake guru is guiding your every action and what you're doing, and you're being led to help them out, free everybody else along with you, that you're part of a divine mission, etc., etc. All this is your own imagination generating all of this. Or you also can feel that you're being guided by some great teacher that was in the past, is now divinely guiding you in some certain way. And that all can be just your imagination too. Just your imagination. You don't really need that kind of guidance. There's not some super important divine mission you're on. The mission you're on is to choose a new idea. And that is something that you can simply contemplate on, and you ask yourself, why am I afraid to choose a new idea? Why? Because only by finishing, that gives the full help to the world. Gives the full help. You have to finish. You're not doing any good simply assisting someone who has finished. You know, because what they'll tell you is, hey, look, you need to pay attention to your finishing. Don't go out there, you know, putting posters and do all this stuff for me. That can be a supreme waste of time. You should be doing your own contemplation most of the time. If there's some other time set aside to do something, that's another issue. But you have to yourself choose a new idea, not somebody else for you. So it's incredibly tricky, our imagination and our belief in magic and our fear of finishing becomes irresistibly tricky for us. And so we delay, we don't finish, and that's how we react to this delaying that's important. I've been able to, you know, work through it, but it's very difficult. Tremendous disappointment, frustration, and dismay and feeling like, you know, you've been forsaken and all this kind of stuff. But basically, success is the best revenge. In other words, finishing will heal those wounds. Finishing will heal those wounds. And of course, we only do it to ourselves. It's because we want to be prime creator, we have this belief in magic. And this belief in magic is so strong that we believe, you know, we believe that it's going to succeed for sure. Therefore, we don't trust reality. We think reality is going to be under our spell, under our authority, and that we're going to change reality and make a new reality. And so any finishing and accepting reality as it is, we feel that it's going to put us in a completely vulnerable position, vulnerable to magic, vulnerable to the new power that we're going to achieve through magic. And we say, oh boy, that's too frightening. I don't trust reality because it's going to be changed at some point. That's what our belief tells us. That reality is going to be changed at some point, and the less attached we are to reality, the smoother the change will be for us. So we kind of make the fear of continuity in a different way. We think that the closer the more we are to reality, the more pain and suffering we'll go through of a break of continuity, of severe change, and all this stuff will be horrible for us. So we literally think that the suffering we're going through in our lives is much less than the suffering we're going to experience if we have somehow simply accept reality as it is, because it's all going to be changed, all threatened with change, and will be changed. This is all simply mere belief. No truth to it whatsoever. It is the belief in magic that'll never happen, and yet that holds us back. Okay. So you can get to these fears. You can get to them. There's a whole complex of fears that arises. As you get close to finishing, a whole complex of fears arise. And then you look for some trick, you know. There's no trick to it. You need to contemplate it, to look at it, to see it. The seeing dispels the magic, you know. You say, ah, that was just my belief in magic. It's like that. Nothing more. It was just a magical belief, and the fear that arose from that, the fear that I'd have some power over reality, is causing my fear of reality. It's preventing me from finishing, choose a new idea, and then abide in the effects of that idea. It's causing it. A belief in magic is causing that. And so when a lot of us get close to finishing, and then that whole complex of fear is there, it's there for everybody. Nobody can dispel it for someone else, because it comes from our own belief in magic. So even if someone else had made it through, each one that comes, they have their own belief in magic, and that gives rise to a complex of fears that will be experienced, especially when you get close to finishing. That's what happens. And then you think, oh, the one who finished has some magical power to dispel these fears or something. It's not a magical power. It's seeing that all these fears come from belief in magic. And you can't have your cake and eat it too. You cannot believe that you can change the effects of an idea without a belief in magic, and without then the fear that arises about choosing reality, choosing a new idea, accepting reality as it is, will automatically become fearful to you. Automatically. If you believe in magic, automatically. So you're caught between these, you know, this situation that you want to keep trying to change existence, change the effects, because you're not happy in existence. But the more you believe in that, the more you have to believe in magic. And the more that belief in magic, the more that causes you to fear accepting, returning to reality, or accepting reality as it is. It generates more intense fear. So it's a vicious circle. If you don't, if you're not able to sit quietly and don't have as your premise that reality can't be changed, there is no power, will never be any power that can change reality. If you have that as your premise, you know that's true, then you can dispel the belief, you can let go of the belief in magic. You can do that. And that's what's needed. There's no tricks. There's no tricks to it. And of course, we look for a trick. We know we want to have our cake and eat it too. We want to find some way so we can still believe in magic and also not have any fear of reality at the same time. It's not possible. But many have, you know, say they've come up with something, and then they have their, you know, their ashrams, and people, you know, say, wow, here's something. This looks interesting. Here's the magic, you know, here's the solution. Wow, this is exactly what I've been looking for. Some way around all this trouble, you know. But instead of doing that, just spend your time in contemplation. Don't think that you're called upon to save the world. That you have some power to change everybody's minds. It's not true. The only thing that will really help others is that you yourself finish. You do the contemplation. You see through the fear. You finish. And then you tell them, hey, it's doable. And that is the only way you really help out. Truly help out. To the ultimate extent. And to, you know, vastly important extent, because it's motivational. It's truly motivational. Those who have finished are motivational. They're telling us you can do it. There's just this complex of fear you got to dispel. And you have to find out how to dispel that. Not through more magic. Not through more belief in magic. There's a tendency for us to believe we need some super magic to dispel magic. We do not. We do not. We just simply have to realize that magic has no power at all. We'll never have any power over reality. Reality is not at the mercy of belief. Truth is not at the mercy of consensus. Not at the mercy of faith and belief and concepts and words. Truth is not at the mercy of anything. It's not vulnerable. It's not vulnerable to plausibility. It's not vulnerable to any future. Reality does not deal in time at all. It is complete. Always, every moment, it is entirely complete in what it is. It is entirely holy, not missing any parts at all. And as the tapestry is ever expanding, whatever there has been is still there. It is still complete. It is just a complete expansion of this completeness. But it's timeless. It doesn't have a time of searching for some process to complete itself. We say it's eternal. So as bad news, good news. The bad news is there is this fear, complex of fears. The good news is that you have the capability to dispel these fears by disbelieving in the power of magic. And we're afraid if we drop the power of magic that our lives will be powerless. You know, that's another fear. Because the way that we believe that our happiness comes from changing existence, the changing effects, and if we have no power to do that, we're afraid that we'll be completely unhappy and trapped, you know. But by choosing a different idea, we're freed from the effects of another idea, the other idea. We're freed. And we say, well, we don't want to be too freed. Well, choose the overlay, and everything's overlaid, and like, again, a soft blanket of snow, everything still, we can still say, oh, okay, it's all familiar. We can do that. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to change reality, and that's what we get from choosing that idea. So there is a way to work through these fears, to lessen them. You know, the more you use the tools, the more adept you get at using them. It's like that. It's like you need to become a carpenter. You need to build a house, as it were. You need to be able to use all these tools, the level, you know, the skill saws, the sawzalls, the table saws, the chop saws, the glue guns, the painting brush, the gun nailer, the finish nailer, micro pin guns, all this stuff. You know, you're building a house. You need to be able to use all these tools. But as you get more proficient, you know, you're able to do it. You're able to actually do it. So as you get more proficient at contemplation and quietly simply looking at your fear and say, well, you know, why is this fear arising? Where is it coming from? What's it based on? And you become more and more proficient You're able to work through this complex of fear and not trying to grab a hold of some magical hand in doing so. And there, you know, again, you can conjure up anything from in your imagination that will seem to be helpful. And it's actually just a magical appeal to magic. You can do that. So it's better to stay in contemplation and keep working hard at it than it is to think that you're going to be part of some grand revival in the world and to help everybody out that way. Even though you think you're missing your opportunity, you're not. Okay? There is no one who is finished that is going to tell you somehow you're missing a great opportunity if you don't veer away from contemplation and help them prepare, etc., etc. No. They will say, stay with your contemplation. Stick with it. Those who have finished don't need some kind of grandiose help. Because wherever they are, whatever they can easily attract whatever they need to for the situation and then let it all go like that too. They don't need some grand entourage. They don't need some grand production process. They don't need some big song and dance. They don't need you to be setting anything up for them. They can convey what they need to convey, even though you are still focusing on contemplation. They absolutely can do that. And, even if they do have some helpers, those are not the fortunate ones, actually. Don't sell yourself short. The fortunate ones are the ones who continue with their contemplation. Don't sell yourself short, because you can do it. You can dispel these fears. You will do it. You don't have to spend any time as part of any entourage. Because oftentimes the ones that are closest to even the great finishers, they're not the most fortunate ones at all. They're the ones who for some reason have decided to delay a little more, for whatever reason. And somehow this is recognized. They say, okay, you're going to delay, but we're going to put you in a situation so later on you can really get into contemplation. That can happen too. But you don't sell yourself short. Don't fall for any tricks of thinking that you're supposed to help some great movement, you know, that's going to help the world, etc., etc., like that. Forget it. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. The only great movement that could really happen in this world is a turn towards contemplation. And a turn towards contemplation does not come about it comes about through your own determination and willingness and actually doing it. It comes about when you start jogging along. That's how it happens. And you literally can get the motivation to do that from within. In fact, it does come from within. So you don't even need anything external, and you don't even need your internal imagination. You need to, for a moment, contact reality, to experience reality, and then you know it cannot be changed. And therefore, magic is a waste of time, and it's only bluffing. And then you can contemplate from that point, from there, all the way through, all the way through. So our imagination, again, can conjure up anything, any scheme, anything can be imagined, anything can be believed in. There's no limits to imagination or what can be believed in. The only limitation is it's not real. What is belief can never be made real. Imagination can never be made real. But within the context of imagination can imagine anything. It can imagine that insanity will become true, can believe it, and it can tell you all sorts of plausible ways this can happen, and it can be intricate, it can be detailed, you can imagine figures that'll talk to you and give you in details, and this is how you're going to do it. There's no limit what at all to what you can imagine. So your only safety really lies in contemplation of why am I afraid to choose a new idea? That's your safety. If you're there, if you're contemplating on that, magic really has to step aside, has to wait on you. You're not giving any rein to magic at all. And that's the safety. That is really the safety. And even if you see, you know, think a great guru, a great finisher, well, you still have to do the contemplation. You still have to. They can't remove it for you, the fears. They cannot. Because you have the exact same power they have. In reality, all have equal power. Everything, Prime Creator shares all power with everything in reality. Everything, all in all. And so you have the exact same power as anyone, any other aspect of reality, of spirit. And so your belief, you can believe in magic and you're capable of conjuring up anything at all. And there's no one who can dispel it from you if it's against your will. If you want to hold on to it, there's no way that anyone can take it away from you. Because you'll just imagine whatever you want to imagine. So you literally have to use your time in contemplation, use your time to see how magic has held you enthralled. Because it has. Your belief in magic is what holds us, binds us, and keeps us from choosing a new idea. Refusal to choose a new idea is what keeps us bound to the effects of the idea we're experiencing. Only by choosing a new idea, a new causal agent, are we then freed from all these effects that we're now experiencing. You know, impermanence, change, death, sickness, instability, etc., etc., etc. All of that. So many. Such an unpleasant experience. We're bound to that. Magic is what binds us. Our belief in magic binds us to this. Nothing else does. And so we need to see how magic is working, the false formulas it gives us, the way that it makes us afraid, the way that it intimidates us, etc., etc. We have to see it for ourselves, or we won't drop it. The best that any finisher can do is saying, hey, you can do it. It's doable. Keep at it. That's what they do. They say, keep at it. You can do it. But you're the one who has to do it, because you're the one who's believing, and you're using the your creativity, that you have equal creativity. The great teachers, the finishers will just tell you, hey, contemplate more. That's their advice. Do more contemplation. Do more contemplation. Keep at it. Keep working at it. That's the way you will succeed. You have to do it. They can't do it for you. They cannot cross the finish line for you. Maybe they can hold your hand, help you out, but still, you have to dispel the fears. They cannot magically dispel them. You have to see it. See it for yourself. See it for yourself. See it for yourself. And when you see it for yourself, then you have this conviction. Say, aha, now I know that, yeah. I heard what they were saying. You can hear what the teacher's saying, the finishers. But not until you see it for yourself is there conviction. And you need conviction across that finish line. To choose a new idea, you need strong, strong, strong conviction, inner conviction. Not someone else's conviction, your own conviction. Getting dark here, just like it is in the world. World's always pitch dark, but sometimes it seems to get even darker. The trust in magic grows stronger, which is what darkness is. Faith and belief and trust in magic is darkness, is delusion. And the world can place greater and greater faith in magic, absolutely, and does. Sometimes it goes away from magic, other times it goes toward it. Right now it's going toward it, big time. And so you have all the magicians arising. You know, the big time magicians are on stage doing their magic tricks. You know, you're enthralled. How's a magician doing this? Some part of you knows that it's fake, but we want to suspend, you know, we want to believe in it. Like, yeah, it's fake now, but at some point it will become real. If you've ever seen a magic show, it's like that. You know the magician is fooling you, but it's kind of like you want to be fooled, and you think that at some point the magician's going to do something that is magical, truly magical, transmutational, miraculous. And so you continue on paying attention to the magicians. Don't pay any more attention to the magicians. They'll never do anything miraculous. There is no miracle. There are no miracles except saving you time, saving delay. That's it. That's it. Everything else is just belief. All sorts of the miracles of, you know, any physical miracle, walking on water, floating in the air, all that kind of stuff. That's just based on belief. That's all. It's all imaginary. It's still just part of our play of imagination. Within the play of imagination, you can transmute energy endlessly. But energy itself is merely imaginary. Okay? So it doesn't matter. Forget about those types of miracles. The real miracle is simply a miracle of saving time, helping you contemplate, helping you see how magic has been playing you for a fool, helping you set that down, realize it has no power. Those are the miracles. That's what miracles mean. They don't mean all the kind of stuff, the physical, the healing, the walking on water, the levitation, all these, you know, all the psychic power, all that stuff. Those aren't miracles at all. That's a waste of time. Don't have any interest in that stuff. Drop your interest in that stuff. Miracles, again, are that what saves you time towards choosing a new idea. Seeing that which enables you to see clearly how the play of magic has fooled you and intimidated you, and recognizing that it's much ado about nothing, that it's not fooling reality, it's not intimidating reality, it has no power over reality, and we're still part of reality, and there's no bridge we have to cross. We nearly need to choose a new idea. That's not crossing a bridge. That's exercising choice, which is natural to reality. As it gets darker and darker, you have to keep boosting the gain, right? As the world believes more and more in magic, you have to keep boosting your contemplation and seeing through magic, seeing that it's fake. It will never be real. It has no transmutational power, no transformational power at all. You can transform symbols endlessly. They're still symbols. You can transform hypotheticals endlessly. They're still hypothetical. Reality can never be transformed. Nothing in reality is ever transformed or transmutated or changed. Everything that has ever been still is unchanged. They're just a continual expansion of richness. But there's never any transformation, ever. No change, ever. It's completely changeless. It has no vulnerability to change whatsoever. And yet in existence, everything can be changed, and we can call it miraculous, you know. I mean, the stuff that we do now, I remember the story of someone walking on water somewhere across from an island to the mainland, you know, supposed to be great, and someone says, yeah, you know, why not just take a boat? It's a lot easier. Or we say, why not just take a plane, you know, if you want to get somewhere fast, why levitate? Why not just take a plane? Or, you know, we're doing all sorts of manipulation and transformations of in energy, all the time. That's what we do. That's what the intellect does. That has nothing to do with transforming reality. Nothing to do with it. It's just symbols. Symbols are completely malleable. Our imagination, our beliefs, our symbols are completely malleable. We can do whatever we want to with them. Really. But that's much ado about nothing. Complete waste of time. Forget about trying to develop some kind of powers, you know, of any type. The only power you need, you already have, which is the power of choice. You already have it. You just need to exercise it. That's all. Exercise the power of choice. And you already have that power. You just, again, we're not exercising it. And so as the magicians, you know, take the stage, forget about it. Forget about the magic show. Your own contemplation is infinitely more valuable to you than watching any magic show. Because you'll have spent that time seeing, aha, oh, so that's what I've been wasting my time on. Okay, let me not do that anymore. And, well, you know, you'll waste your time. We're so addicted to it. We're so familiar with it. It's like somebody who goes into a bar every day of their life, you know, and they finally stop drinking, but they still wander into the bar, right? And they kind of just want to hang out there. And everybody else is drinking around them. They kind of get the feel of it, you know, still have the feel of it. It's like that. You know, we still will wander into that bar of magic, the magic bar, and hang out there. But try more and more and more not to wander into that bar. Stay away from it. Very important to stay away from it. It's dusk now. Dusk is ascending. Beautiful dusk here. All sorts of magic is beckoning you. Come see this magic show. And say, well, I've been there and done that, seen that, and it's, you know, waste of time, waste of time. And of course, you know, we don't think we can spend all our time in contemplation. So we're looking for, what is it? What is the best magic, you know? Well, there really is no good magic. There really is no best magic. And that's the truth. Because there is no magic that works. So, if you're not contemplating, you need to kind of keep your attention from being drawn into anything. You need to kind of dodge it. Don't get pulled in. Don't get focused on any magic. Kind of realize, no, that's not it. And make your way that way. And then you get back to contemplation. Don't get sucked into the magic and thinking that you need to be the magician's assistant. And if you're the magician's assistant, somehow it's going to make the magic real because you're such a great assistant. Nah, it doesn't work that way. Thinking that can happen, right? You think, the magician says, look what a great magician I am. The only reason why I can't make it real is because I need a great assistant. Is there anybody in the audience? Anybody at all out there who has what it takes to be my great assistant? And you may say, you know what, I think I've got I can do it. And then so you get up there and you're doing, you know, you act as the magician's assistant. And then ultimately, of course, it doesn't become real. And you think, oh, it was all my fault. I wasn't a good enough assistant. And the magician will tell you that too, that you failed. You failed me, the magician will say. I've heard that one before, right? Like the great guru is going to save the world and he has all these assistants, the great magician guru, and it all fails, it all falls apart, and the magician is so upset and says, you all failed me. You didn't believe in me enough. You're lousy disciples. You didn't have enough love. You didn't give me your energy. You didn't give me enough. You didn't open your heart to me. You avoided relationship with me. You did all this stuff. You're failures, miserable failures. How terrible you are. And puts it all on you. Instead of saying, guess what? Magic doesn't work. It'll never work. There's no such thing as a great magician. No such thing. How can anyone be great at nothing? How can anyone be great at accomplishing the impossible? How can there be any greatness there? There isn't. And how can it be said a great delayer is what they are? But why, how can we use great in that context, in that meaning? They can just say they're an abysmal delayer, maybe. A very unfortunate delayer. You can even say that, but don't even need to say that. Just move on, you know. Next, you know. Get on with your life. Get on with your contemplation. We've all been a magician's assistant at some time, and probably blamed ourselves, or the magician blamed us, saying, you know, we're incompetent. We couldn't make it real. If we were just more artful, we could have made it real. Just didn't write the right songs, compose the right songs. If we just composed the right songs, it would all become real. If we just made the show perfect, you know, the audience would have been convinced, and the magic would have worked, and everybody would have been saved. That's what the magicians tell you, that you can save the whole world all at once if you just make the magic real, and the audience, well, automatically, everyone will be saved. Boom. You've done it. All you have to do is make the magic real, and they tap you on the shoulder and saying, hey, you got it. Well, you got what it takes to be this my assistant, and you can help me make it real. And you think, wow, how fortunate I am that this great magician guru thinks that I have the right stuff to help them make it all real and save the whole world. That's exactly what happens. So, you're either a magician or a magician's assistant. You have been at some point in time, and now you need to be divesting yourself of that. It's like you bought into it. You bought stock into that company. Start liquidating your stock in that company, divesting yourself of that, and move it over to contemplation. Move that stock into your own contemplation, because you have what it takes within you to dispel your belief in magic. And you realize you do that by choosing a new idea. You can't be loyal to keeping the idea of trying to be prime creator and dispel magic at the same time. You can't do it, because that entire idea is based on magic and the belief in magic, that magic can make hypothetical real. The entire idea is based on that. So there's no way you can want to keep that idea without having this profound belief in magic. It's impossible. Now, you can want to have a smooth continuity in choosing a new idea. You can do that. If you choose the idea of not trying to create not trying to be prime creator, there's a smooth transition, continuity, gentle snowfall, change in perception, and yet everything still remains. You're just seeing it in a different light, as it were. You see the overlay, the unconditional love overlaying everything simultaneously, same intensity everywhere, totally calm, still, gentle. That is what you can do. It's the idea is there for you, waiting for you, and your power of choice is with you. Can never leave you. You've always had it. You just chose not to exercise it. That's it. You think that somehow you've lost the capability just because you haven't exercised it for so long. You think it's out of shape. It's not. You can. It's still totally functional. It's like a radio that you've had sitting out in the shed for 30 years, and you go and you turn it on, and you think, it's you know, it won't work. Click, turns on. You know, no problem. You're hearing the music just like that. It's just we haven't utilized the power of choice. We haven't utilized it for so long. We assume maybe it's disappeared. It's no longer there. We're afraid it's no longer there. No, it's still there, entirely there. Totally functional. We just have to utilize it. That's it. And those who finish, they show us, oh yeah, it's still there. No worries. They help in that way, but they can't choose it for you. You have to choose it for yourself. You have to exercise your own power of choice, because that's how you function in reality. That's how you function, by choosing ideas, choosing experiencing. You're the driver. You're the driver of your experiencing in reality. Some strange birds there, making some at dusk the animals make strange noises sometimes. I don't know what they are. They're getting ready to sleep. disinvest from the magicians. No matter what a slick top hat they're wearing, you know, no matter how dapper their coat and tails and, you know, their getup is, and how perfect their smile is and their show and all this kind of stuff. It's very entertaining, but it's very time wasteful for you. Very bad situation for you. Very regrettable. You don't need to be a magician's assistant. What you are is infinitely greater than that. You are spirit. You're a child of the prime creator. You are one with all of reality, all that is and all that ever will be. You are one with that forever, eternally one with that. You have everything. You have everything. You just don't have the power to dispossess yourself of everything. You don't have the power to change reality. So, spending time as a magician's assistant is a waste of time. It's folly. It's a very seductive folly, which is why we need to talk about it. And it, just talking about it, it lessens it a little bit, but it's still there. You know, it's still there. You're still vulnerable to it. We're all vulnerable to that because we keep believing in existence. We want this to be home. We're familiar with it. We don't want to leave the comfort of familiarity. We don't want to. Which is why the overlay is so important. Choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Has an overlay of unconditional love, you don't lose continuity. You don't lose continuity. You don't lose familiarity. Familiarity is in the background. It's still there. It's kind of like this shadow here. There's a shadow on my body here. You know, it's there. So we don't have to experience a severe break in continuity at all. No trauma at all. There's no trauma. Again, imagine that snowfall blanketing everything. Not a blizzard, just a gentle dusting. Where is the trauma there? Where? You can whip up a trauma. I mean, if you're good at whipping up trauma, you can scream, you're traumatized. Oh, look what happened to my garden. Look at everything. Oh. But if you're, you know, sane and you look at things and you're not into trauma, you'll say, ah, how beautiful. No problem for anything here. It's like that. So unconditional love, you should just say, ah, how beautiful. How delightful. That which used to constantly trick me and deceive me and bring me so much suffering and misery, now it's all overlaid by this delightful overlay that is so wonderful. That's our goal. That is the goal. And we just abide in that. Abide in that experiencing. No need to change it. No need to change it. So we don't need any magic to change it. It's not going to vanish just because you don't try to make it better. Don't try to improve it. Remember, it's the idea of not trying to change reality. So that effect of that idea is effect that is... You're not trying to change. There's nothing, no agency trying to change it. Just it is. You experience the isness of it, of that effect. And then that brings out the perfume of remembrance of reality, which is what we need. We need that perfume of remembrance. And to simply experience that. So the overlay of unconditional love doesn't change at all. It doesn't get more intense. But our remembrance of reality grows and grows and grows naturally as we allow it to. And it's smooth, very smooth. So don't say, yeah, let's make this a magical night. Say, let's make this a contemplative night. All right? Because you're either pursuing magic or you're pursuing contemplation. Those are the two choices you have in this world. If you're not doing contemplation, you're pursuing magic. Pretty much so. Or at least you're fending it off. And again, very few spend all their time in contemplation as possible. That's ideal. But again, you're either, basically, just think of it as I'm either contemplating or wanting to contemplate, or I'm pursuing magic. That's the only two options we have in this world. Either we continue to pursue magic, or we decide to pursue contemplation. That's it. Nothing more than that. And you will see that this is true. And you might say, oh, there's no way I can contemplate all this time. You know, it's too much time. Well, bit by bit, you can do it. You can do it. That's like saying when you're young, you say, oh, there's no way I can drive, 1,000 miles. But as you get older and you drive more and more and more, eventually you think, well, I can do a 1,000-mile trip, and then you do it. So as you start out, it might seem, well, I can't do much of this. I'm no good at it. But you keep stick with it. You start having more success. You have more and more success. You start seeing how magic has been tripping you up, and you realize, hey, I can see it. I can see this. Then you're willing to do a little more. Success breeds more activity, more effort. And so it's a positive spiral there. So if you can watch these videos, you may have some insights and say, oh, I can see that. And you say, oh, I can really focus in on a satsang. Satsang is part of contemplation. It is a certain form of contemplation. But it's not meant to replace your own contemplation. It's not meant to replace that. As far as just being quiet with your own thoughts, it's not meant to replace it. What it is kind of a motivational thing. It's like saying, yes, you can do that. Yes, you can do contemplation. I'd like to see, some world figure get up and say, yes, you can do contemplation. And that is what I am here to help empower you to do that. I want to have everything configured so you do contemplation. That would be great. And of course, religious leaders are supposed to do that. Like to hear a lot more of that, but don't wait on that to happen. Don't say, well, I'm waiting for some religious leader to empower me to contemplate. No. You have the power within you. Remember, nobody's more powerful than you are. It's all equally powerful. You're a total genius. You can contemplate. You can use your genius to contemplate instead of imagining how magic might finally succeed. You can use your genius. You can be a genius at contemplation, really. Absolutely. I feel I've done that. I feel I've been a genius at contemplation. Found a way to do it, to get it done. And so I know you can do it also. Everyone can. But in doing that, I became less and less of a genius at magic. Much less and less and less of it. Just the motivation isn't there. Motivation isn't there. Used to be a really big genius at magic, but then I've gradually said, no, that's not it. And now not so much at all, and no desire to really pursue that, seeing the folly of it, the suffering, the wasting of time, all of that terrible. So yes, you can contemplate. Yes, you can. Just use your genius in that way, and you will find out. You will just find out you have a genius for it. You'll discover that you have a genius for it. You really do. You will think, oh my gosh, I thought I was completely inept at this. And you'll find out that you're not so inept at it. There'll be a revelation for you. It'll be like a miracle. You say, oh my gosh, I thought I'd be a complete failure, totally inept, and yet here I am, and I'm peeling back the layers, Peeling back the layers. You're able to do it. You're able to peel away these layers of magic and discard them. And you'll see that you really are a genius at this. And then you will continue on as you see that you're such a genius at this. Why stop? Why stop? And even if somebody else says they're a great genius and you should be their assistant, you'll say, well, wait a minute. I'm a great genius at this too. Why should I stop? Why should I stop? Why don't I finish? I'm capable of finishing this. Really, that is the truth, that you are just as capable at finishing as anyone else has ever been or ever will be. Nobody has a greater genius than you to finish and choose a new idea. No one. You're second to none. You are second to none. So why should you stop for the sake of who? For sake of what? Don't stop. Don't stop. You can do it. You are, again, a total genius at it, and no greater genius. There is no greater genius. Ever. Just that you know, the time you take will be the time that you take. It doesn't diminish your genius at all. It does not. All right. That's a good place to end. Very positive, very affirmational, and very true. Okay. Very great. That's it for this video.